This video is about the carry skip adder, which is an adder faster than the conventional ripple carry adder. First of all, we remember the full adder working. We call the delay of the XOR gate tsum divided by 2 and the delay of the AND and OR gates tcarry. So, for the first carry out, we have to wait tsum half plus tcarry, and for the first sum, we have to wait tsum. Now we see the delay of 4 bits ripple carry adder, which is composed by 4 full adders. All the A and B bits arrive parallel, as well as the first carry in, or C0. We saw already the first sum S0 arrives after tsum delay, and the first carry arrives after tsum half plus tcarry. For the second sum, we have to wait the previous carry and then the XOR delay, so the second sum arrives after tsum plus tcarry, and the second carry arrives after tsum half plus 2 tcarry. The third sum is this, and the third carry is this one, and so on. So, in general, the last sum comes after tsum plus n minus 1 times tcarry, and the last carry comes after tsum half plus n times tcarry. So we see for both sum and carry, the problem is the carry propagation delay, which must pass through n or n minus 1 stages. So if we consider a 16-bit ripple carry adder, we have to wait the larger between tsum half plus 16 tcarry and tsum plus 15 tcarry for having a stable data on the output. We assume the largest between the two times is the time of the last sum, so ts15, so tsum plus 15 tcarry. So, in general, we assume the ripple carry adder delay is this one. Now, let's see if we can build a faster adder. We have to face the carry propagation problem. So, let's see how the carry is produced. In the table, we see that when A and B are both high, we generate always a carry. So, we can write the carry out is A times B, or A and B. Then we focus on this part here, and we see that the carry out is produced when exclusively A or B is at 1, so when A XOR B is high and the carry in is high. So we can add this part of the equation. We call this part the generative part, because if A and B is high, we always generate a carry, and this other the propagation part, because it allows the propagation of the carry in as it is, whether high or low. This last part here, we call it the deleting part, because A and B are both zero, and even if there is a carry in, there isn't any carry out. So, if A and B are in the generative or in the deleting part, so if they are both 1 or both 0, it doesn't matter the carry in, because the carry out doesn't depend on the carry in. But if we are in the propagation configuration, then we propagate the carry in whether it is 0 or 1. So we decide to divide our n bits addition in blocks of k bits each. In our case, n is 16 and k is 4, so we have 4 blocks of 4 bits each. Let's see the working of a single block. We remember that the propagation bit P is the output of the first XOR of the full adder, and we can use it to skip all the propagation line of our block. But only in the case in which all the propagation bits of the 4 full adders are high. So, if the AND of all the propagation bits is high, we let pass directly C0 through the multiplexer, otherwise we let pass C4. If we put 4 blocks together, we have a 16-bit adder, because in every block we have 4 full adders. This configuration has the pro that if all the propagation bits of a block are high, the carry in skips the whole block. So now we can define the critical path of this circuit. The longest path is when we have a generative or deleting bits in the first 2 bits, in the sum of A0 with B0, so we wait the carry times of the first block, which is tsum half plus 4 carry times plus the first multiplexer time. Then we skip 2 blocks, so we count just 2 MUX time, plus the time of the last sum S15, which we remember is tsum plus 3 tcarry. So in general, the longest path is this one here. Why this is the longest path? Because if we have a generative or deleting bits later in the chain, for example in the XOR of bits A8 and B8, so that P8 is 0, well, in this case we wouldn't care about the previous carry and the time would start from here to the end, so the path is shorter. Note that for the longest path we wait S15 and not C15 because the last block is in skip mode, because if this were not the case we would have a generative bit in the last block and the path would be very short. So if we remember the time for the 16 bits ripple carry adder, we see we have some advantage in the carry skip adder or CSA. Now, let's see what happens if we put K to 1. In this case, we have blocks of one full adder, so it is like to have a ripple carry adder using the propagation and the generating logic, so we assume the delay is that of the ripple carry adder. If we put K equals to N, we are always in the ripple carry adder situation because we have only one block of n bits, so again the delay is that of the ripple carry adder. So how to choose k value for minimizing the total delay? So if we see the timing equation of the carry skip adder and that of the ripple carry adder, we note that the delay has a linear relation with n, but in the ripple carry adder the slope is t carry and in the carry skip adder the slope is t max over k, so we may be tempted to increase k. But we saw that if k is equal n, we come back in the ripple carry situation, and we see in the equation that the delay has a linear relation with k too. So plotting the carry skip adder delay as function of k, we have the two extreme points with the delay equals to that of the ripple carry adder, but there is a minimum between them, and for finding it, we derive the delay t carry skip adder with respect to k equating to 0. So this is equating to 0, and isolating k we find the optimum value of k that give us the minimum total delay. Of course we have to take an integer value of k.
Please leave me a comment and let me know if you liked this video. Make sure you put the thumb up, click the notification bell and subscribe to my channel.